Each year, Microsoft Research hosts hundreds of influential speakers from around the world, including leading scientists, renowned experts in technology, book authors, and leading academics, and makes videos of these lectures freely available.
Ready to start now? It's fun to have Andrew Torrence here today. I met Andrew. We were both sitting on a panel together back in, I think it was March. And after the panel, we had lunch together, and we had a few conversations about the kinds of things he was doing and interested in. And I thought that folks here would find it interesting, but in particular our patent team. And we'll be having a lunch with some of our patent folks at noon today. The open talk is frosting on the cake. And so we'll be giving that talk this morning here. Andrew is a professor of law at the University of Kansas, a visiting scholar at the MIT Sloan School of Management, and a fellow at the Grutter Institute. His interests include patent law, computer simulations of the law, empirical legal studies, biolaw, drug regulation, and biodiversity. Andrew's been a visiting professor of conservation biology at Harvard in the past. He's also been a visiting professor of law at the University of Washington across the lake, and Kansas University faculty president. He received his PhD in biology of all topics from Harvard University in 1997, and then went on to Harvard Law School in 2000. So today I asked him to talk about a set of topics that I thought would be most interesting to both legal folks and researchers, and in our lunch following this, more of a closed lunch, we'll meet with our legal team. So, Andrew.
Thanks very much, Eric. I really appreciate the invitation to come and speak. I've never been to Microsoft, not just to this building, but I've never been to the campus in general. So it's a pleasure and an honor. And I think for me it'll be fun. Hopefully some of you will stay awake till the end. But what Eric and I decided is that instead of delving incredibly deeply into one thing, I would present you with a few topics that to me are very interesting, and I think they're extremely timely. So what I'll talk about is the Myriad decision, the decision that just invalidated unmodified DNA sequences as patentable subject matter. And I've been working on this for about 8 years. And to me, the path towards Myriad was a straight line. And thank goodness, at least for my research, that the Myriad decision came out the way that it did. Not thank goodness for biotech, but it allowed my research to sort of have a punctuation mark at the end. So I'll talk a little bit about that. Then I'm going to talk about patent games. A colleague, Bill Tomlinson, and I, we have developed a simulation of the patent system called the patent game, and we've played it with groups of human subjects under different conditions and come up with what I think are some surprising results. They may not reflect reality, but they've helped us delve into some other questions. Then I'm going to talk about design patents, and specifically design patents on computer-generated imagery, such as, for example, the icons on your Windows phone or your iPhone if you're heretical. And one set of very interesting doctrinal questions that make one wonder whether these things are indeed design patentable. And we know that the courts are dealing with these cases. The Samsung Apple case was a big, big deal and resulted in a damages verdict for more than $1 billion on design patents. So I'll talk a little bit about that. There's sort of a hidden nugget behind the design patent on computer-generated imagery issue that I want to share with you. And then I'm going to end with a depressing litany of Supreme Court decisions over the last decade that have, I think, weakened patent rights. Now, depressing to some, elating to others. I'm not going to take a position. But altogether, I think this presentation is sort of a questioning of some of the orthodoxies of the received wisdom of patents. So I'm going to start with what I call nothing under the sun that is made of man. This is a riff off of a decision way, way back in the 80s, 81, Diamond v. Chakrabarty, where the operational phrase that the court used was that anything under the sun that is made by man is patentable. I think it's actually not true. I think the involvement of human beings leads to the opposite result when it conflicts with the patent system and the Supreme Court. So basically, I'm going to talk a little bit about ownership of living things. Then I'm going to talk about patents that cover things like physiology, stem cells, organisms, thought, and genes. I'm going to offer a couple of potential explanations, one of which I favor more than the others. And I'm going to conclude that ownership of biological inventions, physical, patented, or information, is quite challenging, and in light of Myriad, more so even than that. So you probably have heard of Henrietta Lacks. There's a best-selling book, it's still a best-selling book, that talks about a very unfortunate African-American lady whose cells were taken from her body for surgical purposes and translated into a cell line, the HeLa cell line, that I think is about two blue whales worth of cells now in laboratories around the world. She and her family were not compensated, and the book is really wonderful in talking about issues of civil rights, medical research, etc. There's another guy named John Moore, and John Moore also had cells removed from his body. John Moore sued the doctor that took the cells out. The doctor had patented the cells. Turns out that they were useful for a variety of purposes. And he ended up essentially losing as being an inventor on the cells simply because they came from his body. But the court did say, you know, you have some ownership right in your own cells, and really, doctors ought to tell you before they take your stuff and make it property. So patents. Why do we have them? Well, they're in the Constitution. They've been in the Constitution from the get-go. And they're there to promote the progress of science and useful arts by giving people a limited monopoly over certain types of subject matter. The traditional claim is you need patents because without them, you're not going to get as much of the kinds of useful things that society desires, things like medicines, cars, computer operating systems, etc. Patents are valuable, at least in some fields. The evidence is strongest for biotech, and there's a scholar named Sheila Jasanoff who wrote a book called Designs on Nature, which talks a lot about how the biotech industry became closely entwined with the idea of patents being valuable, in part because biotech for many, many, many years up till the current day has not yet made a profit as an industry. But what they do is they're exceptionally good at producing a certain type of product, which is called a patent. So they're really good at producing patents. They're secondarily good at producing drugs, but mostly they produce patents. One day they may produce both. One day the drugs might outweigh the patents. But at the moment, biotech really relies on patents, and a lot of the drugs are aspirational. There's a bunch of hurdles to getting patents, many of which you may be aware of. It has to be new in a couple of ways, both trivial and sort of significantly new. It has to be useful to a certain extent, although this is a fairly low hurdle. It has to be disclosed well, things called written description, enablement, best mode, and definiteness. It has to be described in such a definite way that the public would understand what they can and can't do, sort of having a fence around your property. The fence has to be visible. If it's not visible, then it's unclear whether people are trespassing or not. And eligible subject matter is really what the line of cases leading to Myriad talks about. There is generally very, very liberal standard in what you can patent around the world. Most patent law is now informed strongly by the World Trade Organization's TRIPS side agreement. The TRIPS side agreement, it says, generally speaking, you should offer patent eligibility in every field except for certain things, and countries may make exceptions, for example, if it violates morality. It may also make exceptions if they're animals other than microorganisms. In the US, a seminal case back in 80, Diamond versus Chakrabarty, said the laws of nature, physical phenomena, and abstract ideas cannot be patentable. That's a principle that holds today. But anything under the sun that is made by man can be. And specifically in this case, there was an oil-digesting bacterium which had been genetically modified. So organisms and genes, according to this decision, appear to be patentable. Since Chakrabarty, all sorts of biotech inventions have been patented. Products of human physiology, what are sometimes called in vivo conversion products. Inventions using human thought, like methods of diagnosing sickness, embryonic stem cells, organisms, and genes. So I'm just going to quickly go through these categories and try and convey to you that what started out looking patentable ended up not being terribly patentable, and I think the common element is that they had to do with the human body or human structures or human functions. So in vivo conversion involves chemicals that start out in one form, and when you put them in the body, they change form. And you can patent what's outside the body, the prodrug. You can also patent what's inside the body, the drug. Sometimes the drugs are literally produced by being in the gut and being subjected to enzymatic conversion. So there's lots and lots of in vivo conversion patents. And there hasn't really been very much of an issue in the patent office about issuing them. There's been a lot of litigations involving in vivo conversion products. These are essentially all of them right here, 11. And what's interesting is that despite the fact that the courts will often say at the beginning of their decisions, of course products of in vivo conversion are patentable because anything under the sun made by man is patentable, in this case, it's not patentable, or in this case, it's invalid, or in this case, it's not enforceable, or in this case, the evidence just isn't there. Essentially, it's impossible to find an example of an in vivo conversion product that has been held patentable in a court. So that would make you, I think, question the value of your portfolio if you have a bunch of in vivo conversion patents, and a lot of companies do. The PTO says, yes, you can, and then the courts, when push comes to shove, says, you can't. It's a case called Mayo versus Prometheus that was decided not this year but last year by the Supreme Court, and it actually talks about metabolites, metabolites of thiopurine drugs. And this case introduced the issue of whether you could patent a method of taking a sample from a human, using information from the sample to make a diagnosis, using the diagnosis to calibrate a treatment, and then, for example, if a patient needed more of the drug, injecting more, or if the patient needed less, then lowering the injection schedule. So it involved not just the use of information, but also manipulation of the human body. Well, this went up and down in the courts several times. It went to the Patent Appeals Court, the Court of Appeals for the Federal Circuit, twice, and the Court of Appeals for the Federal Circuit seemed to think it was patentable. And in the end, the Supreme Court, after giving that court, the patent court, two chances, said no, it's not patentable. Again, not terribly good for the biotech industry.
Why is it?
Well, I think the reason is that courts are reluctant to give patent rights to anything that has to do with the human body, possibly to do with the 13th Amendment, possibly to do with, I hate to use this phrase because it's going to sound trite, but you know, a gut reaction that people have that humans are not patentable. Even aspects of humans, even things that the human body does, even human thoughts applied to things. Courts and people in general do not react well to the idea of property on that subject matter.
But when they write up an argument, what do they say?
Oh, they use all sorts of different arguments. If I can go briefly back to this here, there's no consistent argument that the courts use. They bend over backwards in all sorts of ways to come to the same conclusion. I don't think they want to come out and say, despite what the Supreme Court said, you can't actually patent anything under the sun that's made by man. But what they do mention, and I have a paper that sort of catalogs the rhetoric, not the part of the decision that you can count on for the rule, but the sort of, you know, the musings of the judge. They often talk about differences between what's outside the body and inside the body. Things that are natural versus unnatural, things that are synthetic versus part of the body. So a lot of that rhetoric to me has to do with some sort of magical patenting boundary that's just around here on the skin. Now, I know that's not very sophisticated and very scientific, but I think you'll see in the line of cases that I've looked at, it's a pattern that holds true for every area of biotech that involves the human body. So we've got these metabolites. The Supreme Court sort of is the capstone decision on that line. Then we've got human embryonic stem cells. And what's sort of fascinating is that a European patent called the Edinburgh patent almost by accident ended up claiming a human being right in the claim. I don't think that it was intentional, and it was picked up by folks who realized how bad that was and opposed to the patent, and the patent owners quickly said, oh, gosh, we didn't mean to include a human being in the claim scope, so they cut it back not to include a human. But this got a lot of people thinking about human embryonic stem cells and patents and whether they ought to be patentable.
You say, if we go back to the previous slide, the claims are directed towards a method of isolating or enriching, and so the method of interacting with cells. I mean, why do you say it was claiming part of the human?
Sure. If you look at claim 48, it's a method of preparing a transgenic animal, and then if you look into the specification, and for those of you who are not patent folks, and you should be proud about that, the specification can often breathe life into what the claims mean. So if you take this claim 48, transgenic animal, and then you go to the specification, it says animal cell is intended to embrace all animal cells, especially mammalian species, including human cells. This is a routine piece of language that you find in a lot of biotech patents. So read that back in, and it's a method of preparing a transgenic human. So that's one of the reasons why people reacted very, very badly in Europe to this patent. Did you want to follow up?
Well, I bristle over the fact that I think it's really a method of interacting or creating things, and I don't, it's not claiming part of the human being itself. It's a method of doing something.
Well, it's a method of making a human being. Do you disagree? Claim 48, it's a method of preparing a transgenic human being?
And so was the controversy over the ethical issue that you mentioned in TRIPS before, that making human beings is bad, is that what the controversy was?
Was the controversy from TRIPS, is that what you're...
Yeah.
The controversy actually was more centered on European law, and actually there's a more recent case called the Brüsseler case, where the European Court of Justice said, you cannot patent human embryonic stem cells. And so that's another part of this trend, but this is a very early part. This is 1999. This is only a couple of years after the first human embryonic stem cells became, you know, sort of known in the press, well, created, in fact.
But it would seem like there's a difference between patenting a human embryonic stem cell and patent a method for causing
making
them to reproduce.
I agree with you. There would seem to be a difference. What seems to happen consistently, though, the closer you get to the human body, the closer you get to a human entity, the more the courts seem to bristle, and the more presidents make statements about it, and the more the European Court of Justice says no. And it's interesting. I'm not suggesting that there is a scientifically defensible principle here. What I'm saying is it's more a kind of a feeling about humanness and ownership of humans. Yes?
All right, I'm just a little confused. The patent itself, was it meant to cover the particular method of coaxing these stem cells into reproducing, or any reproduction of this line of cells?
There were a whole bunch of claims that ran the whole gamut. This one here is a very general claim. It's just a method of preparing it, and then it gave steps for how to prepare it. There were other method claims for preparing it as well.
Hypothetically, if one of these cells were to grow into an entire human, and 15 years later that person reproduced with another human, is this where the problem starts to arise?
That would certainly be a problem if reproducing fell into somebody's claim. Pretty sure the human would win, not the patent holder. But I think you're touching on something that's really important. People are worried not just about this language, they're worried about the implications downstream. There's a case that I'll talk about called the Monsanto case, which dealt with reproducing seeds. And it's interesting, seeds are not humans, and the Supreme Court found about a month ago that the patent rights are sort of refreshed every time you plant a new seed. So you can plant a patented seed, as long as you have a license right from Monsanto, and then it grows, and then it makes new seeds. If you take those seeds, and if they're still covered by the patent and you plant them, the patent rights are renewed every time you use the seeds. So every generation, the patent rights are renewed, which is in contradistinction to the exhaustion principle, which I'll talk about at the end, which says once you buy a patented item, you can really do whatever you want with it. You can't reconstruct it, and you can't make copies of it, but you can do whatever you want. So after the first sale, the rights of the patent are exhausted. But with respect to these seeds, they seem to be renewed every generation. And I'll talk a little bit about the facts of that case. With respect to humans, though, I think a court would find differently.
Yeah, with the seeds case, though, you could also use that as multiple copies, too. So
you could use it as multiple copies?
Yeah, I mean, you're planting one seed and you're getting thousands and thousands of seeds.
Right, so and I think that's a policy reason why the court found the way that it did, yeah. But there was a legitimate argument on the other side that once you plant the plant the first time, all further uses were part of the exhaustion rights. Just turns out the court didn't agree with that.
Just a guess, a summarizing kind of question.
Sure.
Is it the case that, your area particularly personally is bio, your training and so on, but is it the case that if you take biology and patents in biology, the human entity stands out as special for a variety of semi-rational and rational and emotional reasons from bio? Monsanto seeds, chemical synthetic biology, human body, human being special.
Yes.
What you found.
Yes, I agree. Exactly. I call it a human bar to patentability. And I like the fact you called it semi-rational, because I agree. It's not a rational principle. It's a semi-rational, semi-emotional principle. So this stem cell this stem cell issue came up in the U.S. as well. The Wisconsin Alumni Research Fund has some of the fundamental patents on human embryonic stem cells. These have been challenged and challenged and challenged and weakened and knocked down, both here and in Europe and in other countries, so much so that the company that was the great hope of human embryonic stem cells, Geron Corporation, which had a license to these WRF patents, it literally got out of the business a year ago. It decided that this was not a fruitful area because the patents were dying. So there's been a big backlash in the public, and there's been a big backlash against stem cells. And I think I mentioned already that this European Court of Justice case, the Bustla case, said you can't patent human embryonic stem cells in all of Europe. How about organisms per se? Well, in the US, it appears you can. In Canada, where I happen to be from, you can't. You can't patent so-called higher organisms, despite the fact that that's sort of a nonsense term in biology. You can't patent higher organisms. Although, in Canada, a couple of years later, it turned out you can patent every single part of a human, a higher organism, including all of their cells or their genes. And in fact, those are better rights than having rights to the whole organism. But the US has been pretty consistent. You can patent things. Monsanto case, I think I already covered this. Essentially, it was a farmer who sold his seeds to a grain elevator and then went around back and bought some seeds, the mixed seeds, and then replanted them. And he thought that because he'd sold them, these rights had been exhausted, and he could buy the mixed seeds from the back, which of course were all Monsanto seeds, just from different farms, and then go and plant them again without Monsanto's license. Monsanto disagreed, went to the Supreme Court. Supreme Court sided with Monsanto, but these are not human cells. So there's a bunch of patents that involve, you know, methods of human thought. And there's a doctrine called the mental steps doctrine that essentially says the closer this is to simply human thought that's not tethered to something in the real world, the less patentable it is. Now, this became a live issue again in both a non-case called Laboratory Corporation versus Metabolite, a case that made it all the way to Supreme Court. It was a method of diagnosing a person, made it all the way to Supreme Court. And when everybody expected a decision in 2006, instead, the court said, oops, we never should have taken this case, and they sent it all the way back down. They were probably waiting for...
just want to clarify.
Yeah, sure.
In diagnosis, that there are procedures like Bayesian updating from symptoms to probability distributions over diagnoses, right? You could say that's mechanized thought written down as laws of probability on paper.
Yeah.
But we don't call that thought necessarily. These are principles of sensor fusion.
Right.
So what about the diagnostic policy was a thought?
So in this particular diagnosis, it was a method of diagnosing a certain deficiency. And the doctor would take a sample and examine the sample. And if the sample was, you know, high, they'd look at a chart. And if it said high, oh, this guy has too much. And if the sample said low, this guy has too little, so treat him accordingly. Or if he's in the middle, he's healthy.
But what's the thought part of this?
The doctor taking the results of the test and looking at a chart. Yeah.
But that can be automated, right?
Exactly. And so I think you're onto something important here. The closer it is to something that a human can do or does, and this has a lot to do with how you claim the invention, the more likely it is to be found barred as human thought or barred under the mental steps.
Area of artificial intelligence is about replicating human and going beyond human abilities.
But I would predict that...
this read on that, those cases.
What I would predict is that the more you put this into a machine, the more a machine does it and not a human, the more likely you're to have patentability. The more you have a human involved, the less likely it's patentable. But there's a number of cases where people have come up with methods of alternative dispute resolution. And, you know, 10 steps, you get the people in a room, you give them water, you say, hello, how are you? Hello, how are you? You try and get them to some sort of common ground, and then you have them sign a paper. People have actually filed and received patents like that. So you might think that's just ridiculous claiming, and maybe it is. But it reveals a principle here, which is the closer it is to the human mind, to human thought, the less patentable.
But I've never heard discussions of these cases in my whole entire career in machine learning and reasoning. And for example, in the 80s, people would build rule-based expert systems in medicine. They take expert doctors and they have them reason about these modular rules, and then they would chain them together like doctors do. Mm-hmm. No one ever said, by the way, you can't patent an expert system. expert human knowledge is encoded in a fund of knowledge that's being used in a system, mm-hmm. and it's reasoning like a human. That was like the you know, thumbs up, the
yep.
capturing the protocol correctly. I've never heard about people saying that's thought, you can't patent that.
Well, I would say just be increasingly careful, because a series of cases, including, I'll just skip to the Bilski case. The Bilski case has a lot to say about okay. systems sort of like that. No. It's they're great questions. The Bilski case, the Prometheus case, and even the Myriad case all talk about methods that involve both some automated steps and some human steps. And to the extent that there's a human involved, that's where it seems to get dangerous, at least according to the court. Now, one of the reasons you may not have heard of this is these issues don't come up very often, and they didn't used to come up very often at all. The court seemed to be either comfortable with patent rights or completely bored by patent rights, so they never take cases. The last 10 years, though, the Supreme Court has taken case after case after case. It's an embarrassment of riches. The more they look at this stuff, the more they expound about human issues.
I'll take one more comment.
There's a rising field called human computation and crowdsourcing, where there are programmatic calls to people to do tasks like on Mechanical Turk, for example.
Yeah.
Human thoughts being used in larger algorithms. We filed a number of exciting patent applications. I think exciting because they cover lots of rich technologies that are about how you build algorithms that learn how to use people ideally
yeah.
and use their thought ideally in larger systems of problem solving. I'm chairing a conference on this in June, in
yeah.
November. The fact that these Supreme Court rulings might read on this whole new area, very exciting work about human-computer symbiosis, is.
But isn't it different to patent like an algorithm for what you do with the output of the human?
And by the way, you cannot patent an algorithm per se. That is black letter law. But you can patent the application of the algorithm to a problem.
Okay.
Yeah. So if you're ever drafting, don't say, I claim this algorithm. Say, you know, I claim a method of blah, 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 blah.
Let me chill out here, take a deep breath.
Sure.
These cases here.
Absolutely, absolutely. Well, first, I hope that your exciting cases are exciting scientifically,
yes.
but they don't excite the interest of the Supreme Court. That's not the kind of excitement that Microsoft or any other company needs.
You can still do your conference without patenting what you
do. So we don't patent everything, of course, but,
yes.
thing, but these are... I would say some of the most innovative things that I think I've done in my life, and therefore I want to share them and
yeah.
protect them for Microsoft.
What I would say, like as a prescription though, is that patent attorneys are able to adjust to this. They're able to claim it in a different way. So don't claim it as involving human thought. Claim it not using human thought. Automate it. Don't claim it as an algorithm. Claim it as a method of applying principles to some tangible result. So there are ways around it, but there is a fundamental principle, which is watch out. The more the Supreme Court looks at things and sees human thought, the less they like the patentability of that. Sure, yeah.
These cases?
Oh, sure, absolutely. So the Abrams case is just an old case. It says self-evident that thought's not patentable. Gottschalk versus Benson, a Supreme Court case that talks about the unpatentability of purely mental steps. That would be the alternative dispute resolution system, which is kind of silly anyway. I mean, maybe it's an effective method, but the patentability of that appears silly to me. Then Diamond versus Deere, the court started to pivot a bit. This is a year after Diamond versus Chakrabarty. Diamond was the commissioner of patents. And said that mental processes and abstract intellectual concepts are not patentable, but it also laid out the patentability of some thoughts applied or algorithms that were applied to, for example, curing rubber. And then Bilski dealt with an investment method that was sort of like the alternative dispute resolution. It was heavily human intensive. It hadn't been automated to the extent that probably the inventor should have to get patents. Prometheus versus Mayo, this is the one that I told you about, taking a sample, making a judgment, calibrating the treatment. And then the Myriad case involves taking a genetic sample, seeing if you've got the BRCA1 or BRCA2 gene that's indicative of higher percentage chance of breast cancer or, to a lesser extent, ovarian cancer. So it involved method steps as well. The Supreme Court punted on method steps in Myriad. In Prometheus, I'd say it cast tremendous doubt on the patentability of of methods that even involved the manipulation of a human body. They weren't just simply looking at a chart. They actually did something to the human body. Okay, gene patents. A lot of people have protested the possibility of patenting genes. Michael Crichton's my favorite quotation. You or someone you love may die because of a gene patent. Gene patents are now used to halt research, prevent medical testing, and keep vital information from you and your doctor. This was on in the New York Times, the front of the review section, I think, in 2007. So this attracted a lot of attention. Interestingly, genes weren't always seen as something that were potentially patentable. There's been all sorts of different concepts of genes, from units of heredity, but we don't know what they were, to the word gene, to genes as particles, genes as DNA sequences, then genes as information in the 60s, and then genes as computer programs, and then finally genes as biobrick parts, synthetic DNA, which you've probably all heard about. I've done a lot of work with the synthetic biology community, seeing genes as little bricks that you can plunk together and make things with.
Did any of those concepts lead to, like, Watson and Crick algorithmic patenting? What did Watson and Crick do about when they discovered the sequence?
As far as I know, they didn't engage in patenting at all. I think the Nobel was enough for them. There are alternative rewards available. So there's been sort of an assault on gene patents since about 2005. So fragments of genes were found unpatentable, not by the Supremes, but by the Patent Appeals Court, the Court of Appeals for the Federal Circuit, in 2005, on the grounds that they were only part of an invention, not a whole invention. That was bad for Craig Venter and Celera, because a lot of their patents were on fragments of genes. There's empirical evidence that actually there's very little litigation that goes on, despite all of the worries that Michael Crichton and others have talked about. There's been all kinds of congressional activity trying to ban genes as patentable subject matter. And there's a fascinating, which have not passed, by the way, yet, but there's a fascinating section to the American Invents Act, Section 33, which is not codified. And what that means is, if you look up the law, the American Invents Act, you look up the law, as it's codified into the American legal code, you won't find Section 33. Well, does that mean it's not law? No, it's law. It's just hidden law, and it appears that there was some sort of compromise. Section 33 says you can't patent a human or anything directed to a human. That's sort of, you know, loose, weaselly lawyer language. It's right there in Section 33, but it's not right there in the patent code. But it is law, but you can't find it unless you know that it's there.
Directed to mean?
Good question. What does it mean? Nobody knows yet. The courts haven't dealt with it. But I would say that directed to means broader than just a human being per se. So it could be really broad or it could be narrow. But I'd say that my research suggests it's probably on the broader side.
So I said on the slide, if you have an inventor that is in the lab and building genes, just on his own, or her own, a sequence that has some interesting properties that they haven't discovered anywhere in biology. Uh-huh. It's a new gene, it's really cool, has a great effect.
Yep.
They seek a patent on this, and it goes through the system, and it's a great patent, it's licensed everywhere. And then some animal or human is discovered to have a mutation that has this gene forming naturally in their body, but no one ever knew about it before.
Yeah.
It appears in biology all of a sudden, 16 years later. What does that mean, given current law about this kind of thing, unprecedented?
Well, so you're probably okay, at least for those first 16 years, because if you synthetically produce the gene, that's exactly the kind of DNA that I think is highly patentable. But in part, it's highly patentable because it's nothing to do with the human body. It's not plucked from it. It might be sort of inspired by it, but the more synthetic, the more designed, the more modified, the better, the more patentable.
But the minute it's discovered
somewhere. So the minute it's discovered, an issue arises in patent law. Was it inherent in nature? Was it something that existed in nature already?
Let's say it was.
Well, let's say it was. So the issue then would become, is it inherent enough that you immediately lose your patent rights? Would that be a good way to defend against a patent suit? Or could the patent office simply say, oh, now that we know it's out there, we will get rid of the patent rights? It's quite possible, because inherency is a powerful doctrine. And the idea is exactly what you said. If it's out there in nature, even if you don't know about it, oh well, too bad, so sad. You can't get a patent on something that's out there in nature. On the other hand, if you take this to the extreme, to the sort of ridiculous extreme, there may have been every version of a synthetic gene at some point in the history of, you know, evolution. And so does that make them all unpatentable? My guess is the courts wouldn't go that far. The courts would say, look, this guy didn't take it from nature. He wasn't inspired by nature. And a reasonable person could not have found it. And so therefore, he gets to keep his patent rights. But it's a great question, because if it was easy to find, or if it was straightforward to find, and the guy didn't find it, then it probably would nullify his patent rights. It's a great question. So do human genes have patents or not? Well, the ACLU said they shouldn't. And to everyone's surprise, a court in the Southern District of New York said, absolutely, you should not get patents on unmodified genes. And they even said mean things like, you know, the practice is a lawyer's trick. Mean to lawyers, but maybe, you know, nice for other people. So the district court said no. Big surprise to people. This went to the Patent Appeals Court. They said, no, no, you can patent patents. I'm sorry, you can patent genes. We've been doing it for a long time. So then the Prometheus case was decided by the Supreme Court. And the day after, the Supreme Court said, hey, Federal Circuit, take a look at our new Prometheus case, apply it to this gene question again, and take a second shot at seeing whether genes are patentable. So went back down to the appeals court. They looked again. They said, yeah, yeah, even with Prometheus, they're still patentable. And then oh, I'm sorry. Prometheus was the treatment case where you take the sample and then you figure out whether the person has too much or too little of a metabolite, and then you calibrate their treatment. Yeah, sorry about that. That's the Prometheus case.
I thought that was the thinking case.
Bilski. And well, so Prometheus is both, because it's methods of thought plus things that actually do, like, make a change in a tangible fashion. So the Prometheus case was that case. The Supreme Court decided it and immediately said, Patent Appeals Court, look at this case again. You get a do-over. You might think that's a strong signal that maybe they had got it wrong. But the court didn't say, you got it wrong, and you have to find the other way. They just said, take a look, now that we've elucidated this area of law. So they looked at it again. They said, no, they're still patentable. Then it went back up to the Supreme Court. And about, what, two weeks ago, almost exactly, the 13th, the court said, you can't patent unmodified human genes. The court did not give very much guidance about what you could patent, but it suggested that once you started to modify them, they were probably on the more patentable side. And the synthetic genes you're talking about, highly patentable, I would say. Yeah, so you get this rather big decision for biotech. Myriad Genetics, that owns the patents for BRCA1 and BRCA2, its market cap has gone down significantly since then. Interestingly, right after the decision, it spiked up by about 12%. People thought, whoa, did we not read this case right? And then it started decaying and decaying and decaying. And I think about a third of the market value of the company is gone now. On the other hand, generic companies immediately leapt into the market and offered the test that's normally $4,000 for, I think, now down to $300, some of the competitors are offering it for. So why is it unpatentable? Well, maybe it's just really complex. And if it's so complex and ununderstandable, maybe you can't get a patent for that, because you're not really teaching the public anything that the public can replicate. Maybe there's a morality issue. And certainly there is a view, an old, old view in patent law, that things that are immoral should not be eligible for patents. For example, Judge Story, a famous judge, said, things are unpatentable if they're injurious to the morals, the health, or the good order of society. That's a long time ago, though, 1817. Since then, since 1817, the courts have gradually cut back on using morality as a reason not to give patents. And it's such an important principle that actually Einstein wrote to one of his lovers that he really liked being a patent clerk. I don't know if you knew he was a patent clerk. He really liked being a patent clerk because you didn't have to think about the moral issues of the day. You just said patentable, unpatentable. Well, I think that's probably, you know, as smart as he was in so many other ways, maybe that's not true. Maybe there actually are inherent morality issues in patents. Especially biotech, you need to take these into account. Well, not to mention human thought-related patents.
Is there any modern precedent to, like, morality issues like gambling machines being unpatentable?
Well,
like Las Vegas?
No, in fact, this
displays the Las Vegas
some people would like that, but there's the case called Juicy Whip versus Orange Bang, one of the best-named patent cases ever. This was a great case that involved one company that owned a technology for producing delicious, you know, drinks that are swirled around in the plastic container. So you're at a theme park, you come in, you see the delicious orange stuff swirling around, say, I want that. But it turns out that the stuff in the plastic bin, that's not what you get. That's actually highly toxic neon chemical that actually there's a big container below the desk, and that's where they pump the stuff out from. So that's just to get you to buy. And so another company that replicated this swirly machine, this is fascinating to me, they said, you can't sue us. These kinds of patents are immoral. Which means we can do it too without infringing. They ended up losing, and the court said, look, moral utility has not been applied broadly in recent years. Basically, the patent office has nothing to do with morality. Patents are here, morality's here, never the twain shall meet.
Is this still done? That's scary. No, I meant the actual invention itself. I had no idea I was probably buying something else.
I would never impugn the morality of vendors. You know? I'm sure it's exactly what you see that you get. Yes?
Okay, but is it just that what we would consider so morally reprehensible today that we wouldn't want to give a patent on it is just not something people are trying to patent, like a gas chamber or, you know, a torture machine or something crazy like that?
People do try and patent those things. Now, gas chamber, I don't know, but they do try and patent things that a lot of people would consider highly, highly immoral. You can imagine the sorts of areas of subject matter that people might, you know, patent dangerous or torture devices. If you try and patent thermonuclear weapons, you can patent them, but you'll immediately get a visit from the government, and they will ask to have those patent rights, and you may not be able to talk about it ever again. That's right in the patent laws. There are certain so dangerous inventions that you can't get the patent for your purposes only. So anyway, basically, patents are not really a moral subject, but maybe they really are. Maybe underneath the surface, morality still bubbles along, even though the courts pretend that they don't. I think this is the best explanation, humanness. All these inventions have to do with the human body, structure or function of the human body. That's, to me, the most uniting common theme. And the 13th Amendment is, I think, a really eloquent expression of what we think about human bodies and ownership. I personally think this is the most consistently reproducible reason why courts decide against all these human inventions. There's another one, and there's lots of unease in the law about human patents, including the Europeans who come right out and say the human body at various stages of formation and development and the simple discovery of one of its elements, et cetera, cannot constitute patentable inventions. So the Europeans are sort of explicit. I think the American law is more implicit. It sort of bubbles up. The Europeans just come out and say it. Human body's not property when it's alive, at least not in the US. It's not property when it's dead either, which actually leads to all sorts of black market trade in parts from morgues. And it's in general never really been something that the law has seen as ownable bodies, except for slavery. And we, you know, fortunately have the 13th Amendment and other like amendments around the world that have ended that practice. You know, human data seems to be protectable. I included this for Eric's sake. And the American Invents Act Section 33, this sort of half-hidden law. By the way, it looks like it was a compromise. People said, no, you can't ban kinds of inventions. And other people said, well, we really want to ban human inventions. OK, fine, you can ban them, but you can't put them in the law where people will find it. A weird kind of congressional result. There's another theory that maybe there's just a repugnance. I think, again, the repugnance has to do with the human body, but economists have called this a sort of repugnance idea. So the idea here is that, you know, the law, of course, can ban things that are bad for society, and that the patent law doesn't override that. I think that biological inventions are vulnerable, especially in light of Myriad. I think the markets have agreed with me on that. There's all kinds of significant legal milestones that all, to me, lead in the same direction. And, you know, whatever the explanation, I'd say that human-related biological inventions not highly patentable. Okay, so I'm going to change direction, and I'm going to do this one fairly quickly because I really want to show you the results more than the method.
We have till noon, by the way.
Okay. No problem. I mean, believe me, I will fill it. And continue asking questions. I'm happy to take questions.
I guess what I'm interested in is at the Supreme Court level, do you see the prospect of, I don't want to say better educated because I don't want to devalue the statement, but more scientifically oriented legal leadership at that level might see things, might be less semi-rational and be more still look at things as inventions and understand the course of biology and people as just being a bit, you know, where they sit in biological taxa as not being so special. And maybe move away from what I always view as a semi-religious view.
Oh, I love it. I love it. I love your question. First of all, I'm glad you're so optimistic. I'm not as optimistic.
I didn't say what I thought. I said, is it possible?
I mean, it is possible, but here's what runs against it. We have a specialty patent court, and that patent court was originally meant to be sort of consistent, to come up with a consistent patent law, and to be generally pro-patent. Because before 1982, when the Court of Appeals for the Federal Circuit was set up, patents received very uneven treatment and sometimes very negative treatment. There's a great little vignette from this period that involves Thurgood Marshall. Thurgood Marshall was a judge on the Second Circuit Court of Appeals, one of the prestigious courts of appeals, is New York City. And he was being considered for a Supreme Court position. And he was being questioned about his views, as you know, all Supreme Court justices tend to be. And somebody said, you know, Mr. Marshall, what makes a good patent? You know, what makes a patent strong? What's a good patent? He said, I have no idea. And this person said, I don't understand. I mean, the Second Circuit Court of Appeals, they hear lots of patent appeals. You see lots of patents. I happen to know you've heard a bunch of patents. How do you not know what a good patent is? And he said, well, I've never seen one. Now, what that meant was that the Second Circuit was very, very negative towards patent rights. Different circuits have been more pro-patent rights. The Eastern District of Texas tends to be very strong on patent rights, for example. But the Court of Appeals was brought in to make the law consistent and to be more positive. The idea being in the early 80s that the US really needed to smarten up on science and technology, and one way to do that was to strengthen intellectual property rights. So that court came in pretty much with a mission to strengthen patent law. And I think in a lot of regards they did. The consistency helped because people could make rational investment-backed decisions knowing what patent rights were and weren't. But there was also a general leaning towards pro-patentability. They sort of took the Supreme Court's anything under the sun that is made by man as a mandate and were skeptical of cutting the rights back. Well, the Supreme Court has not generally been terribly interested in patent law. But in the last 10 years, they have. In the last 10 years, the Supreme Court and the Court of Appeals for the Federal Circuit have gotten into repeated, I would say, sort of spats. The Court of Appeals for the Federal Circuit will say something, and if the Supreme Court doesn't like it, they'll either say, no, you're wrong, or they'll say, try again. And I think both are equally reprimanding, if you think about it. Well, this has increased, and there's some evidence that the Court of Appeals for the Federal Circuit has reacted by saying, look, we get to hear these cases all the time. We can outlast you. You know, we'll just keep hearing them. When you make a new rule, we'll say, we love that rule. That's the rule we've been using. And then they'll go ahead and do what they did before. You could interpret it differently. You could say that, you know, maybe their interpretation of the Supreme Court jurisdiction or jurisprudence is you know, different than a lot of other people's. You could also say that the facts change the results. So maybe they're looking very specifically at a Supreme Court judgment and saying, well, this really had to do with, you know, a woman named Jane and a man named Fred, and we're here dealing with a man named George and a woman named you know, Diane. You know, so the facts are different, so we don't have to apply the same rule. Now I'm obviously turning this into a little bit of a cartoon, but there's been, it appears, some tension between the courts. Court of Appeals for the Federal Circuit can hear as many cases as it wants. And so it could overwhelm the Supreme Court with decisions. And the Supreme Court is not going to fill its docket with patent cases. But the Supreme Court has upped its intake of patent cases. And as I'll show at the very end, I think it's reacted in a different way than the Court of Appeals for the Federal Circuit. And it's cut back on patent rights. They might say they've put patent law back where it should have been or put it into comportment with the rest of the law. But the Court of Appeals of the Federal Circuit and the Supreme Court are often pushing in different directions these days, which is fascinating to watch. And it may make for good law or it may make for bad law, but it's created a lot of energy and excitement of the good and bad kind in patent law. So let me talk to you about something different, which is experiments. I wonder if anybody knows what the paintings are on the left and the right side. Any idea? Anybody know who the painter is?
Monet.
Very good, Monet. So Monet spent a summer at Rouen in France, basically painting the same cathedral again and again and again under different light conditions. And what we tried to do was we've tried to change a bunch of conditions in a semi-controlled system and see what happens with the shading of the patent law to make it sound more poetic than it is. So this is a collaboration with Bill Tomlinson. He's at the Brenn School of Information and Computer Science at UC Irvine, and research assistants Bryant Davies and Nitin Shantharam. We have created a system called the patent game that I'll sort of show you quickly in a second. And we've tried to test a bunch of hypotheses in patent law. For example, do patents spur innovation? Fairly basic question. And also in patents, do property rights, injunctive relief, the ability to tell people to stop, do they perform better than liability relief or liability rights? In other words, you can keep infringing, but you just have to pay me some sort of a royalty. Those are very different outcomes in cases. Patent owners would generally like the property rights. They'd like to be able to tell people to stop, maybe because they have a better bargaining position to get a license, but also they would like to be able to stop competitors from competing if possible. I'll show you some empirical results. So again, just to refresh your memory, the idea of patents in the first place is to promote the useful arts by securing limited monopolies. And the Patent Act has tried to implement this in the US. There's very similar acts in a lot of other countries, more or less dictated by the World Trade Organization's TRIPS agreement. And again, the traditional claim is without the prospect of patent protection, you get inefficiently few innovations, sort of a tragedy of the commons in a way. Now, the national academies and a number of other organizations tried to look into the fundamentals of the patent system back in the early part of the 2000s. And they came out with a report called Patents in the Knowledge-Based Economy. And I've since had a chance to work with one of the authors. I did a little project for the National Academies last summer on synthetic biology and standard setting. And so I got to talk to him about what he was thinking when he wrote this report, which helped me get a little bit of insight into what they were thinking when they wrote quotations like this. Having reviewed all the literature on patents, the National Academies, you know, this is a consensus organization. These aren't crazies on the fringe. He said the literature on the impact of patents on innovation must be considered emergent. That's a really nice, polite way of saying there's no evidence that patents influence innovation one way or the other. It's emergent. We're just beginning in 2003 to discover what role patents play in spurring innovation. Isn't that kind of fascinating given the fact that the Constitution way, way, way back in the 18th century said the whole purpose of patents is? Well, there's an assumption here. There's an assumption that it does. Another thing they said is the effect of patent policy has many dimensions, some fundamental to understanding the determinants of innovation generally, and these continue to challenge scholars both theoretically and empirically. Another polite way of saying, let's figure out how this thing works because we don't understand and we're not convinced by the evidence out there. This was a comprehensive survey of everything they could find. So we decided that it would be fun to look into this. This project all started when we were looking for a footnote for the proposition, the seemingly easy proposition that patents spur innovation. So I was looking for a footnote, some reference, because patents, legal academics are sort of footnote happy. And I sent my research assistant out. He couldn't find one. I thought, do I have to do everything myself? So I looked. I couldn't find one either. I thought, this is a little bit strange because I thought the whole purpose of the patent system was, and I'm a patent attorney, and I practice patent law. And when I practice patent law, I sure knew that it spurred innovation because I billed a lot of money for it. But it turns out that it's sort of an open question. So we decided that our approach would be simulation games. And there's a bunch of different advantages to simulation games. Of course, there's disadvantages too. But you can enable rigorous manipulation of experimental conditions. You can integrate human interaction with real-time computational processes. So these are not computer simulations with no humans. This is a game that people actually play. And you can allow for precise data collection. So as you can imagine, we logged every keystroke in this game. It's dynamic. It uses human behavior to model human behavior. Lots of data. You can change the parameters. You compare results based on alternative sets of parameters. And you can directly test alternative hypotheses. If it's compelling and fun, so the theory goes, and some of you, for all I know, work in this area, if it's compelling and fun, people appear to forget that they're playing a simulation game. And that's considered good, because then they're playing for the objectives. They're playing for the goals. You only need to explain the rules. You don't have to explain what you're simulating. So as long as people understand what to do, they'll do it. You don't need to explain the background. It's easy to generate lots of good sample sizes. And it's in the law, at least, it's an untapped data source. We wanted to successfully simulate patent systems, collect a lot of data, and test specific hypotheses. For example, how does it spur innovation? Do the outcomes vary with specific parameters? And what is the optimal system for innovation? Well, I'll tell you right away, we've only really done the first two. And our results are by no means definitive. But our goal is eventually to try and come up with a set of parameters that appear to outperform all the other sets of parameters, and then maybe use that to help inform public policy. The patent system can't possibly be optimal as it is, I would think. It would be very unlikely if it were. So maybe if it were more optimal, it would serve society a little bit better. So we tried to make it sort of easy to use. We used Ruby on Rails, which I know is open source. So some people have said, well, used open source, so obviously it was anti-patent from the first, from the get-go. Drag and drop inventing, pull down menus, event updates, auto-refreshing. And the goal for the user is simply to win. And we gave out prizes. We paid users to play, and we gave prizes for winning. So we tried to implement a bunch of things in the patent system in this game. And the sort of joke that I tell is that my collaborator, who was setting up this game, he said, give me the parameters you need. So I gave him a list of about 70. He said, OK, you can have 5. And then I said, well, I really need more than 5. He said, OK, you can have 7. So obviously, it's a stripped down version of the patent system. But you put combinations of elements together to make inventions. You can make things, or you can patent them, or you can do both. There's prior art. So if somebody else has done something, you can't get a patent. You can license. You can sell both in and out. You can sue people for infringement. So if you witness infringement, you can sue them. And you can get both injunctive relief and damages, or neither, or one or the other. So we've got all sorts of different possible treatments. We have a patent term. So often the patent term is something like 10 minutes instead of 17 years. Those experiments would be a little bit too.
Do you capture trade secret?
Well, we don't in most of the versions of the game. But we have one version where you can basically keep the stuff that you're doing secret. We haven't tested it, though.
My initial reaction is that is one of the key aspects of patents. Law allows people to publicly share innovation.
Yes.
And if you're not studying that, I'm not sure how the...
Yeah, so we're doing one thing at a time. We have plans for a bunch of new experiments, two of which I'm planning on doing this summer. And yeah, so trade secrets are one of the things we want to look at. The problem is we want to isolate trade secrets to some extent against patents. So we're trying to design trials where you could adequately isolate the effect of trade secret versus no trade secret and see what the effect is. But I agree. I think trade secrets are very important. Hard to study in the real world because nobody will tell you. Easy to study in something like this because you can hide invention.
Right, but I can imagine a study. I'm surprised there's been studies like this in the past where you find key inventions that were patented, and you imagine a world where they were, where the technology would have been withheld for a year, mm-hmm. in lockdown mode, not being shared. Mm-hmm. It's not even licensing or simple, nuanced variations of that patent, but a whole concept that gets out into the world that fuels all sorts of inventions that you wouldn't even know related to the original invention because they're out there in the world stimulating thinking in general and creativity.
There's a lot of theoretical literature on trade secrets, and there's not a lot of empirical stuff yet, mainly because people just don't want to tell.
I mean going backwards, imagining...
Oh, yeah, okay, yeah.
Imagining
yeah.
patented inventions that if they were delayed by X years in being
right.
publicly described, what that would have done to technology over decades.
That'd be great to study. I'm not aware of studies like that, but you're right.
Asking.
That'd be a great study. Trade secrets are sort of the orphan of IP. They're always taught as an afterthought. I don't know how many people here ever took an IP class, but you the big three: trademarks, patents, and copyright. And then there's usually a lecture or possibly two on trade secrets. It shouldn't be that way because it's a huge iceberg. No problem at all. Any other questions are welcome. There's costs in money and in time in our game. So it costs you money to patent, for example. It also costs you time to make decisions and to do certain things versus others. So opportunity costs. And you can do multiple users versus no users. We can have computers play against each other, but we prefer the putting humans in a room version.
You don't have an option for just releasing it, like open source or anything like that?
We do. It's just that we have so many other things that we've been trying to do. So yeah, we both agreed that we would like to just release this. Oh, I'm sorry. I thought you meant our game.
No, in the game, within the game.
Because ironically, our university's patented the patent game. In the game, we absolutely do. What a great question. Yes, we allow people to open source. Okay. So what open sourcing essentially means is you create your invention, and then you declare it open source, and then nobody can ever own it. So yes, and one of the experiments I'll show you has an open source version right in the data. Okay. So great question. Yeah, I misunderstood. One of the questions people sometimes ask jokingly is, you know, have you patented the patent game or is it open source? We're actually going to release it open source because we haven't pursued the patent. Our university's decided it wasn't as lucrative as they originally thought. This is sort of the interface. You sort of pull down. I don't know if I have a little zipper here, but you pull these little tiles. They can be anything. Here they're A's, B's, D's, and A, B, C, D, and E. They could also be two-dimensional tiles that you fit together. They could potentially be three-dimensional. Then we keep track of how much money each of the players have. We often have, you know, 20 players at once. Here's your portfolio. You know, this is what you own. And if you want to license or sell it, you just click to make it available and you set the price. And then these are other patents that are out there. And each patent sort of has a value. The value is reflective of what you can sell the product for on the market. And then over here, there's events. And the events sort of scroll down. When you have a game with a lot of people going, the events scroll down really quickly. So we can slow the game down as well if we want people to see everything. But in some ways, it's very realistic to have so much information here that you really have to choose what you're going to do. Are you going to be inventing things? Are you going to be making things? Are you going to be watching for infringers? So we can change all of these different parts. There's a bunch of strategies people could use, you know, play it safe. Some people just don't care. They just make everything, whether or not it infringes or not. You can license, sell, enforce. All kinds of mixed strategies are possible. A couple of things before I show you the actual data. People seem to like playing it. They love winning. They invent selectively and strategically. Players often license and assign their stuff. They often litigate. There's a lot of litigation going on. People get really angry when you infringe their inventions. It's fascinating psychologically to watch. And they seem to care about the legal rules. They try and learn what the rules are so that they can manipulate them and win. So the hypothesis, one hypothesis is that if you have patent protection, you're going to get more inventions. We had IRB-approved trials. We tested three systems, and here's your question. So we had a pure patent system. We had a system where you could get patents or you could deliberately open source them. And then we had a pure commons where there are no patents, no open sourcing. So for this particular experiment, here's the sample sizes. The games were 30 minutes long. And only the treatments varied. So one treatment was patents, one was patents plus open source, and another one was commons, no protection of any kind. So here's what we found for innovation. This is number of unique inventions in a game. We found that the pure patent system performed okay. And the patent and open source system performed about the same. They're not statistically significant. But the pure commons performed better. More unique inventions. First year law students who had never taken an IP class before. We've also done tests on IP students who have taken, they've successfully completed intellectual property law. So we actually tested whether it mattered if you knew about IP law. The theory being maybe, if you're ideologically committed to the system, somehow you'll make the pure patent system work. It doesn't work, though.
In the game, there's money exchanged, is that right? I mean,
well, they earn money, and at the end of the game, the winner gets a big pot.
Okay.
And they also get paid for their time.
Okay. That's what, well, in the pure common system, how do people get paid? I mean, who pays
the... Well, the winner. The winner of the game. So the person who has the most money at the end. If I go back to the interface here, I'll show you. We track the amount of money people make. So in the pure commons, you make money by making and selling. You don't make money by licensing, assigning, et cetera. You just make money by making and selling things. You pull down these things, you try and discover, you know, valuable combinations, and then you make and sell them, and then your money goes up. Does that make sense?
You're making and selling something that somebody else can make and sell too.
That's right. In fact, what often happens is somebody will make a valuable one, somebody will spot that, and then everybody will start making the valuable one.
So you've sold it once, and then everybody else is making and selling it.
That's right. In the common system, in the patent system, you make and sell it, and then some people jump on, and then you sue them.
When you're selling, is there sort of a finite amount that the market in the game can buy?
So we've experimented with different, supply and demand curves. We don't know what the perfect one is. Most of these early experiments, you could sell as many as you want and the price would stay the same. So we recognize that depending on, if everybody sold the same thing, the price would probably go down. We understand that that may affect some of the experiments. We've twiddled a little bit with that. We haven't done a full-scale experiment with that kind of a model, but we will.
Sometimes reviewing a paper on this topic, I want to understand robustness of these results. For example, if you change even unspecified nuances that could be specified parameters of how the system works, size of the designs, and the nuances of how things are bought and sold, the robustness of these results, the sensitivity to variation.
I agree. So all I can offer in that regard is I'm going to show you two sets of results. I could show you three sets of results. I'll show you two sets of results with very different parameters, and generally speaking, the results are the same, even when the parameters are very different. So we have not explored that space yet. We've got a couple of different snapshots. The results, the common, seems to always do really well. And the patent system almost always does fairly badly. Yes?
It seems like in the common system, you've taken a user who's got a limited amount of attention, and you've given them, in the three scenarios, you've given them a number of things to occupy them. And in the common one, you've actually reduced the number of things they can do. They can either invent, make, or sell. They can't litigate or license. So could your results just be explained users having fewer things to do, so
they could.
Motion takes up a bigger portion?
They could, yeah, they could. So hopefully, what's that?
Well, it is, but isn't, because you can't hire additional resources here. I mean, Microsoft hired me to do the patenting so that the engineers don't have to.
Yeah.
And it's an added cost, but it's not necessarily that if we didn't have that Microsoft would actually hire an engineer in my place. I don't think that's true.
Now, one of our plans is to automate some of the processes for the players. So allow them to set up a production line and then make the thing without actually clicking a button. And so then they could actually go and do the litigation, et cetera. So we do want to see whether this attention, I like the way that you put it, the attention issue, is a significant driver of the results. We don't really know at this point, but it's a really good point. Yeah.
Also, a question on the pure commons. We talk about selling. If you put something on their open source and you put it out there, you're not making your money off the selling of it.
Right.
You're making it off of some alternative services that you're providing with that.
Right, or reputational enhancements.
So how does that really work in this model? If you're really making the money off the sale, you never have the initial first sale.
Yeah, it's not a very good open source model for a couple of reasons. First of all, it's not copyright-based. Because open source is copyright-based.
Yes.
And this is patent-based. We put this in because we were really intrigued by whether people would choose to make things public. But it's not a perfect analog for actual open source. So I'm not sure I can give you any satisfying answer. But this is kind of a quasi open source, patent open source sort of system. And
but
yeah.
Does that work even with the pure commons?
Pardon me?
Pure commons. What are you selling in the pure
commons? You discover useful combinations and then you sell those. You make and sell them.
It's not necessarily software, right? These could be analogs for machines.
It's fairly abstract. It's A, B, C, D, E, F, combinations thereof.
Are you putting the pure commons under an open source license or not?
No, we just don't even address legal issues. It's just a free-for-all. You just make and sell. Is that...
Yeah.
Make sense? Am I responding?
Why you sell it? I mean, if it's pure commons and you put
It's commons in the sense that you can't patent it, but you can still buy and sell things. So it would be like there were no patents, but you still made software and you sold it in store, and other people could also sell exactly the same software.
So you have an exclusive right over the item. You get to say, "I get to sell this," and nobody can copy it.
In the commons, no. Everybody can copy it.
Well, it's like a drug that the patents expired, right?
Exactly. It's like the patents expired. Yeah.
Is the confusion just the difference between an individual item, like I've got this pen and I have some magic pen copier and I can make millions of them, versus I have this pen and you see it and you make a very sort of similar pen design and make your own copies of your pen that does the same thing as mine, but it's not just a copy. Like, I can sell one pen. Right.
A pen with a certain specification, let's say.
Yeah.
It's a pen that has A, B, C, D, and E. And anybody that sells a pen with A, B, C, D, and E under the common system doesn't have to worry about patents. Everybody can sell that same pen.
But they need sort of the equipment or industrial machinery to make more pens. They can't just snap their...
Right. Although in our system, in this experiment here, it's simply people clicking, like pulling the combination down and then selling it.
Well, is there a cost to that?
There's a time cost.
And so it's not exactly like
we can make a monetary cost as well, but this experiment doesn't have the monetary cost. And this experiment also doesn't have the sort of the automated manufacturer. We want to set up production lines at some stage where you can spend a little time setting up a production line, and then it just goes. And then you go and invent some new things and sell some new things.
Well, how do you model the business risks? The whole premise of the patent system is before you invest in innovation, you want to have a reasonable return for your money. And I don't see where you're modeling the barrier to entry and business risk at the front end.
I agree with you. We're not explicitly modeling. We're not explicitly modeling it. You're right.
Any one of these unmodeled dimensions can change the graphs wildly.
Totally. Yeah. Totally. And we freely admit that. So we're sort of at the beginning of exploring this space. Yes, I freely admit that. And hopefully we can model it better later. Yeah.
To the earlier point about the quid pro quo and disclosure. In the pure commons, is there essentially publication of the invention as soon as it's sold? Like, do I see Bob has sold ABC?
Yeah, it shows up on the little the events tracker.
Have you thought about a way to model that in a commons space where Bob sells something, but you don't know what it is because he didn't patent it, therefore he didn't disclose it?
Yeah, absolutely, like the trade secret. So we have a way of shutting that off.
Okay.
We haven't experimented with that very much, but we would like to shut that off and do a trade secrets experiment at some stage. We just haven't done it yet.
Can you see rice competition modeled in the?
No, we don't yet.
Okay.
So that could also affect.
You're selling something, somebody else is selling.
And the price doesn't go down. Yeah,
okay.
But obviously it should, and so we're working on supply and demand curves and price curves to add into it. Yeah.
I think, so this is all from the perspective of the manufacturers. Would you ever look at it from the, because I think the most important thing is actually from a consumer perspective, does this actually allow me to get a better quality product for cheaper?
Yeah.
And that's one of the most important things, which I think actually the current patent system has completely messed up, if you ask me. So.
Again, we can't really shed too much light on it, but we would like to manipulate these experiments and look into that. But no, I mean, you pay the same price in this experiment here every time. And the quality is, I mean, it's sort of perfect quality. It's got an A, a B, a C, and a D, if that's the invention. Yeah.
So back to the thing about trade secrets. Have you given any thought to partial information or like reverse engineering? Like I can pay a time cost to learn what the other person is selling.
Well, you can sort of do that by event tracking. You can see what they're making, and then you can sort of see whether their profit's going up. If you put those together, if you're careful about that, then you can say, oh, I should be making A, B, C, and D because that's a really valuable invention. But beyond that, not yet, no. Okay, I'm going to show you some more data here. I want to share the next experiment. So productivity, in other words, the total number of inventions that were made, not just unique inventions, the pure commons pulls away. So here's unique inventions. Here's total amount of stuff being made in the system. And then here's the amount of money being made in the system. So statistically, There's no difference between the pure patent and the patent open source model, but in all three, there's a robust statistical significance between the pure commons and the other two treatments. Okay, so you know there's a bunch of different possibilities. What explains this? Maybe the patent game is just really bad. I mean, maybe this is not bad simulation, and that's possible. Maybe we need better parameters, better players, et cetera. Maybe we need psychology students who are the classic experimental subjects, not law students. Or maybe despite the received wisdom, maybe patents are not doing what we thought they did. There's a lot of authors working on this, including Heller and Eisenberg, saying that sometimes you get too much patents and that trips everybody up. That does happen, by the way, in the patent version. People end up not being able to make very much because they're constantly infringing. And it ends up being just this bloodbath of infringement. Then Eric von Hippel has suggested that users and open innovation are actually much more productive than proprietary inventions. Yochai Benkler, Larry Lessig, Besson and Moyer wrote the book Patent Failure, which says that only really in biotech are patents succeeding. And they say in software, not succeeding at all, really messing things up. And then Eleanor Ostrom, similar views, and she won the Nobel. It doesn't make her right, but she did win the Nobel for this view that the commons are maybe better than we think. So we changed the rules a little bit. There's a classic paper in law called Property Rules, Liability Rules, and Inalienability, One View of the Cathedral. That's where the Monet thing comes from. And it's Calabresi and Malamud. They said it really matters whether you've got property rights, that is, the availability of injunctions, or liability rules, the availability of damages. So we did this. We basically looked at property rules and liability rules by allowing people. Oh, and there's strong support in economics, by the way, that you want property rules. Sure. That property rules should give you the most productive economy. That liability rules are unfair because it allows people to, you know, use your property and simply pay you after the fact when you should have the right to keep people out, the right of exclusion. So there's this strong, strong support in the legal literature for property rules over liability rules. So we thought that we would implement this. And here's the hypothesis. Patent property rules will promote progress of the useful arts more than will liability rules. So similar claim as before, it's just now we're varying property rules and liability rules. We did similar experiments, but here are the treatments. Injunctive relief, damages, both, and neither. Same sort of setup as before. Same sort of treatment, same experimental setup, but here are, again, the four treatments that we did. And we measured the same things as before, innovation, productivity, and social utility or wealth, whatever you want to call it. And so here's what we got. If you get injunctive relief and damages, very few inventions are created. If you get just injunctive relief, you get a slightly larger amount, not statistically different. If you get damages alone, it's actually considerably higher. It starts to separate itself from these two. And if you get neither, you get tremendous and unique inventions produced. How about total inventions? Damages do really well compared to anything with injunctions. Commons does, you know, even better. And then in terms of wealth, again, the damages do really well compared to injunctive relief, and there's the neither treatment. So again, the results are you get the most of everything without rules. Things are high with liability rules. So getting damages is helpful. It's low with a property rule, and it's lowest with both rules, but it's not really different. It's the presence of injunction seems to keep everything tamped down. So it's possible that liability rules spur innovation, productivity, and wealth more than property rules if we're reflective of reality. What's interesting is 2006, in eBay versus Merck Exchange, the Supreme Court said you can't automatically get injunctive relief if you have a finding of infringement. Sometimes you can, sometimes you can't. But before that, the Federal Circuit had said you automatically get an injunction if you win a patent case. So it's interesting, the Supreme Court may or may not be trying to say the same thing, that too much property rights may actually be bad for innovation. They didn't say that, but the result since then is that many fewer people get injunctive relief after infringement findings. So choice of legal rule seems to be important. Same possible explanations. Maybe we did it badly. Or maybe there's something here. Maybe our system would be improved if we had damages rather than just property rules being the dominant result. So we're not claiming to be either Calabresi or Melamed or Monet, but we thought the results were kind of interesting. So we've got a lot of other different experiments that we're thinking of for the future. We'll do some this summer. So finally, I'll skip through this one pretty quickly because I think the interesting thing is the current day. Design patents are a different kind of patent rule. They cover designs, not useful inventions. The outline of our argument is that over the years, the kinds of designs that are like computer-generated imagery have not been subject to design patents. And yet, since the last 15 years or so, you've been able to get design patent protection for example, the screen of your iPhone or your Windows phone. This has never been endorsed by a court, and all of the legal authority goes the other way. There was a change made in the Patent and Trademark Office that simply said, okay, fine, we'll let you have design patents. And since then, they've proliferated. They've led to things like the Apple-Samsung case. But there's no good legal authority for it, and I'll try and suggest why. So design patents are one of the ways you can protect visual intellectual property.
Can I just ask a
question? Yeah,
sure. You said there's no court that's weighed in on them. And then in the next sentence, you said Apple's case.
Right, except they didn't weigh in on whether you could get design patents for visual design, or for CGI. They simply said, they assumed that away.
Okay.
So what happens in courts, I mean, as you probably know, is if the court isn't asked the question, it often doesn't answer the question. So you could ask, you know, was there infringement? They'll say yes. If you'd asked, can you even get a patent on this? They might say, oh, that's a different question. No, you can't get a patent on it. So that's sort of the question here. So CGI design patents, there's lots and lots and lots of them out there. In fact, the very first one was a type font in 1842, kind of like a CGI patent. The original statute was sort of written up in an afternoon by the head of the patent office. He just thought, we need protection for designs. So all kinds of things he thought could potentially be protectable by design patents. The design patent law says this: whoever invents any new, original, and ornamental design for an article of manufacture may obtain a patent, therefore, subject to the conditions and requirements of this title. So a lot of the other patent law applies, but there's unique things like new, original, ornamental, and the one that I think is important, article of manufacture. And they're for 14 years, by the way, not for 20 years. There's been a shift over the year in ornamentality doctrine. It used to be that they needed to be pretty to qualify, but basically this fell out of use, and the Court of Appeals for the Federal Circuit more or less removed the ornamentality requirement. And now, as long as it's not functional, it's considered to be ornamental. And I've actually done some empirical and experimental work on this that shows that over the years, since the formation of the Court of Appeals for the Federal Circuit, it's mattered less and less and less whether you're attractive or not. Well, I scored them. I ran a bunch of experiments with students looking at designs in a darkened room. They scored attractiveness. And then I looked at every single case between 82 and 2010 and came up with the result of the case and then put them against each other.
Shockingness and revulsion for the discrimination. Yeah,
exactly.
For a great movie.
Yeah, exactly. So ornamentality's changed over time. This idea of article of manufacture has also changed over time. So from the very beginning, it had to be a physical object in order to get ornamentality, or sorry, in order to get design patent protection. It had to be an article of manufacture, something tangible. A variety of cases involving things that weren't quite physical. For example, cards divided into spaces covered with foil by narrow bands with a dozen pearl buttons and rows of 3x4. Oh, I'm sorry about that. What did I do here? Oh, it looks good there? Okay, I'll just continue on. So if it wasn't physical and tangible, you weren't able to get design patent protection. Here's another one, an album case set on a baseboard in an upright or nearly vertical position, having on its exterior an oval ornamental frame with an open center. Courts didn't like things that weren't sort of physical. So if it wasn't an article of manufacture, you couldn't get protection. Over the years, This was a consistently held principle. And here's an influential case digest. Design patent may be granted only for a design embodied in a material object. 1987, adding mere graphics does not make it patentable. So this is 1987. Here's other examples of things that that may or may not have qualified, but they were physical. A roof, a grandstand. Here's one that was a real challenge. The Hruby case, which was a fountain. Could the pattern of water be a design patent? And the court fairly revolutionarily found that it could. The court said that, yeah, the pattern of water, as long as the pattern is permanent, it qualifies as an article of manufacture. Pre-1996, the patent office said, no, you cannot get design patent protection for something that's not physical. But what's interesting is, and the cases were consistent in this regard, but what happened was the Commissioner of Patents in 1996 just decided that he would change it. He would change the rule and say you could get computer-generated imagery. And here's a case that stands for, some people say, this proposition. But what's interesting is it's a case on type fonts. The only case that's ever found CGIs as design patentable is a case that involves a type font. And think back to the very first design patent. That was a type font. So this is a case that deals with something that has been patent eligible since 1842. It may not reflect computer-generated imagery. So there's a bunch of images raised by computer-generated imagery. They're impermanent. They're everywhere. They're very, very easy to get. And apparently, they're worth a lot of money. The Apple Samsung case would seem to say that they're worth a lot of money. No court, though, has yet determined the patent eligibility of computer-generated imagery. So I think in this field, we're basically waiting for a Diamond v. Chakraborty case, a fundamental case that says what can and cannot be design patentable. In the meantime, every company, including Microsoft, has lots of these things. And they're worth a lot of money. But people don't tend to challenge. Why? Well, why would Samsung or Apple challenge the patent eligibility of the thousands and thousands of design patents that they have? So I think we're waiting for a decision here. So my final slide, what I've done is I've looked at all of the Supreme Court, the significant Supreme Court patent cases over the last decade. And I tried to divide them up into different categories. And all of these cases except one are negative in their results for strong patent rights. So it's been no friend to strong patent rights. Injunctive relief, the eBay case said, you don't necessarily get it. Exhaustion and jurisdiction, well, Microsoft versus AT&T said, infringement outside the US is not something that you can enforce within the US. Quanta, the Kurtzsang case, which is actually a copyright case, both say that exhaustion rights, the first use of something, exhausts the rights, and the patent owner has no rights after that. The Monsanto case, the seed case, goes in the other direction, but that may be because it's a living invention and it's really important to agriculture and it's not human. Patentable subject matter, we talked a lot about this. There's been a narrowing of patentable subject matter, particularly in the area of thought, algorithm, and human-related inventions. Non-obviousness, it's harder to get a patent now, presumably, because the non-obviousness standard in KSR versus Teleflex appears to be a higher standard than it was before. Then licensing issues. It used to be that if you had a license, it was rude in the legal sense to challenge the validity of the patent in the license. But the MedImmune versus Genentech case says, no, you can be a paid-up licensee and sue to say that the patent is invalid at the same time. Stanford v. Roche, you've got to be really careful about ownership of inventions. You better nail those rights down right away, because otherwise, the inventor initially owns the rights, and they might be able to leak out of the company or the university. And then finally, a case that was just decided last week, the FTC versus activist case. It's a generic drug case, but the really, really interesting thing is that patents were originally created in the Statute of Monopolies in 1642 in England as an exception to the rule against monopolies. So no more monopolies, but patents stand alone. So it's long been thought that antitrust concerns don't apply to patents per se. But this case suggests that the FTC can investigate people who have patents and for the uses of those patents in a way that was probably unclear before. So patents now seem to fall under antitrust guidelines along with all of the other restrictions on patent law.
What happened in that story? What was the story there with activists?
Oh, this is what's called a reverse payments case. So a drug company had a drug that was under patent, and it was coming towards the end of patent, and a generic company challenged the patent. There's a whole pathway for challenging patents, the Hatch-Waxman Act. They challenged the patent, and in response, the drug company said, what if we pay you not to challenge us? And the company said, how much? And they came to an agreement that seemed mutually beneficial. Having come to the agreement, the drug company was able to keep making a fairly large monopoly profit, and the generic company was happy, I guess, because they agreed to the the reverse payment settlement. So they made money for doing nothing, and the drug company made money under its patent. The FTC thought this was anti-competitive, that the whole point of Hatch-Waxman was to get generic drugs out there and to challenge patented drugs. But the fascinating thing is that now explicitly we have a Supreme Court case that says antitrust scrutiny can be made of people's patent portfolios. It probably was always true, but now we have fairly strong authority that you've got to be careful of the antitrust implications of your patent uses. It's a big deal, I think. So I think the trend in general is clear. Patent rights have been sort of chopped away at the sides, and in some cases more fundamentally than that. I don't think the Supreme Court has been a pro-patent court. And I think the trend probably continues. So that is what I have to say.
Thanks very much.
Thank you.